Hello out there. How are you all? Hope you're fine. Good morning. I don't know where you're watching me from, but wherever you're watching me from, I bid you good morning. I actually want to talk to everybody. I want to talk to as many Christians that are out there that are good morning. God bless you. There are many Christians that are out there complaining about the church, complaining about pastors. I have a burden in my heart that I want to share with you all this morning. The Lord has a word for you. Everybody talks about pastors do this, pastors do that, pastor did this for me. He did that, they took my money, they slept with me, they are so bad, they are so evil, they are so everything. I agree with you, it's true. But let's look at it, the subject subjectively, okay? One, who is a pastor and what is his work? Okay, I call this video candid camera, all right? I believe that is a food for thought for you that is listening to me. And the Lord actually wants to speak to somebody. The Bible says, Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Don't allow the enemy to use you as a gate of hell to pull down the church of the living God. Yes, there are different pastors out there. But what Who is a pastor and what is he supposed to be doing as a pastor? A pastor is a man, flesh and blood, just like you and I, who is born again. All right? Who has received Christ and has also gone further to receive a call, a grace, a burden to be a pastor, to be like a shepherd watching over sheep. Okay, and he has responsibility. One of it is to feed the sheep of the Lord with knowledge and understanding. He is to tell them the truth, because the Bible says the church of the Lord is the pillar of truth. All right, he is to watch for your soul. He is to nurture you as a baby into Christianity, into maturity. He is to guide you, is to teach you the word of God, is to preach the word of God to you, is to remind you things you've known, is to tell you the things you've not known, is to counsel you in the right way. And he is also to dispatch the grace of God that is on him upon you all. That's all his work. His work, let me tell you, his work is not, I repeat it again, his work for you, I'm repeating it again, is not for you to, is not to lay hands on you for you to receive, that is not part of his work. His work for you is not to cast out the demons in you. All those things that you are expecting, that you are expecting him to be God. No, Jesus said, those that receive this word and are baptized, including you, that you are pointing your hand to the pastor, you will cast out devils. You will lay hands on the sick, they will recover. You will drink poison and you will not be harmed. You will lay hands on the sick. All right? It is for you as well. It is for you as, it's not just for a pastor. It's not part of his duty as a pastor. It's not. You need to understand that. You see, everybody's expect pastor to be God. You see him as God. He's not God. He's just man. He's flesh and blood like you that has more responsibility on his shoulder. So now he has a wife. He has aspirations. He has burdens, his own personal burdens, he has his own personal problems. Just like you are seeking the Lord for a problem, he has his own as well. He's also seeking the Lord. He's also working out his salvation. He's also flesh and his blood that is subject to temptations and trials, just like you are. He's not God. That's one thing everybody has forgotten that. And there are different types of pastors. I named them, I put them into three categories, the types of pastors we have out there. The first one is a true man that is born again, spirit-filled, and truly called by God to be a pastor. All right? Then the second type is those that are just born again or not even born again, but they've learned the ways of pastors and they put it, they see it and say, okay, they can do this, and they're also doing it and probably doing it for money, doing it for the honor, for the glory, doing it for, you know, as they see things, they've watched the pastor for a while, they've seen how it's done, they have charisma, and they do it as well. While the third categories are those that are not human beings. Did you hear me? The third categories of pastors out there, they are not human beings. They are not flesh and blood like us. They are from the pit of hell. They are agents of darkness. They meet with the devil to come to earth to deceive man and woman, to deceive men. All right? There are three categories. The one that is man and is born again is subject to temptations, to like minds, to everything like you and I, who has a problem also that is seeking the Lord for, who has aspirations, who has a place that he wants the Lord to take him to. And now the Lord says, I have this burden I put on you. I put this grace upon you. Go and be a pastor. I put this job up, this responsibility on your shoulders for you to do for me. That's the first category and the truth category. The other one, the second one, are those that feels that they have charisma. They have talents. They are natural leaders. They know how to cajole people. And they can put the things in place that they've seen done in church. And they can demonstrate it and pretend it also. And they call themselves pastor. And then the third categories are not pastor. They are not human beings at all. They are from the pit of hell. They are agents of darkness. All they are doing is to deceive the body of Christ. So when you are talking to pastors, which one are you talking to? Is it the third category that is from the pit of hell, that Satan has sent out here to deceive, to kill, to steal, to destroy many lives? Or the second category that put it upon themselves and feels that people are following me? After all, people are following me. I have the charisma. I have the talent. I'm not called by God. Yes, there was not a time that God called him. There was not a time that the Holy Spirit ministered to him to go and do this. The grace is not on his life. But he has taken it upon his life and said, I can do this. And all of you are following him. All the first one that is truly called by God, it is not because he has the talent. It's not because he's trained for it. It's not because of anything, but because there is a grace. There is a call that he has even rejected and said, God, I don't want this. But God is saying, no, you must do this for me. Which one are you talking about? And then let's come back to a pastor slept with me. Pastor slept with me. Pastor slept with me. Are you sure it is the pastor that slept with you, or you slept with the pastor? Especially we women. The pastor slept with me. Number one, before he slept with you, didn't you know he was married? Did he force you? Was it a rape? Who was it that seduced you? Did he seduce you, or you seduced him? It is a woman that seduced a man. Let's be careful what we say. Everybody out there, be careful what you say. Who seduced you? Let me tell you, for before you become a man of God, before you receive the anointing, or before you now declare yourself a pastor and people are seeking you, there is a labor that you have put in place. Every pastor put it. I need you all, as many of you there that are talking pastors down, that are pulling pastors down, that is ready to destroy the church of the Lord. You know, a lot of people don't go to church now, or they talk down pastors and say there is no need to go to church. Why? Because pastors did this, pastor did that for them. you answer before the judgment, the throne of God, and you will give account of yourself. That account that a pastor did this, pastor did that, from that's why I don't go to church, that's why I'm a sinner, that's why I do this, that's why I do that, it will not justify you before the judgment throne. I need you to understand that. So be careful what you say. More so, before a pastor becomes a pastor, before he has the anointing, and the anointing that is now attracting everyone, I have this problem, I have this challenge, oh, pastor, help me, for me. Pastor, help me. Pastor, pray for me. Pastor, do this for me. He has labored before he received that anointing. He must have fasted. He must have prayed. He must have locked up himself somewhere. He must have sought the face of the Lord before the anointing came upon his life. And now the anointing is there. And every one of you see the anointing, because anointing attracts. Okay? So now you see the anointing and you are now seeking the man of God. And then you bring him down by seducing him and sleeping with him. Because the anointing that is put upon any man of God, if he's a man, is in his palm. You need to understand that. Every one of you that is talking down pastors, if he's a true man of God, if he's truly been called by God, if he has sought the face of the Lord, if he has put in time, he has put in effort, he has put in his money, he has put in his life, he has put in his family, in his ministry, and you now say he slept with you. No, he didn't sleep with you. You slept with him. You took the anointing upon his life. You reduced him to nothing. That's what you have done. So before you go around saying it and pulling him down, you know, it's not even enough for you that you have pulled him down by taking the anointing on his life. But now you still use your tongue again to trash him, to kill him. You are not guiltless before the Lord. Don't think that you are guiltless. He is the one that slept with me. No, you slept with him. You destroyed the anointing in his life. You took it away from him. It's not him, but you. You know, all women, we are so soft. When we, and it's not just women, everybody, I'm looking for problem. Just touch me and let my problem disappear. I have this problem. I have that problem. You got to that problem by your choices, by your decisions, by the choices that you have made. And it is by making the right choices that you are going to come out of it. It's not by somebody just laying hand on you and the problem will disappear. You need to understand that. You take poison. You took the poison. And you now say, lay hands on me and let this poison not kill me. It will kill you. Except by the grace of the Lord. It will kill you. Except by the grace of the Lord. And then he will, the assignment of the pastor is to tell you, is to teach you, is to give you understanding according to the word of the Lord. So when you go out, you make the right choices. But if you refuse to eat the word of the Lord and you continue to make your wrong choices, and you are praying and you say, pray for me and let my problem disappear. It will not disappear. It's not a curse. It's not that I desire that you should not come out of your problem. But as long as you continue to make the wrong choices, you will get the result of your choices. You need to understand that. You need to understand that. A lot of women blame pastors. Even men now are helping to blame pastors. Yes, you help to blame them. Yeah, or it's easy to blame them because they have no voice to defend themselves. They have no voice to talk because you think that, trust. They could not talk because they are falling. That's why they cannot talk back. That's why there's no defense for them. They cannot say, this is what happened. A lot of pastors are being seduced. They are not the ones seducing you. You are the one seducing them. You reduce them to a loaf of bread and you take the anointing that they've worked for, they've lived for, they've consecrated themselves. They have sought the face of the Lord. You took it by one night, spending 5 minutes of sexual pleasure with them. You took it away. That's what you do. So don't say that pastor, because after the pastor slept with you, didn't you go to the church again? Or you didn't know that he was married before you eventually slept with him. Eh? Remember the woman that prepared a room for Elisha and Gehazi. Did the Bible recall that when he prepared the room, he would go and stay in the room with the man of God and be telling the man of God, that man of God, oh, see, I'm married to my husband and I don't have a child. And you stay there, only you and the man of God in the room. Did the Bible recall that? Anna, when Anna was going to receive Samuel, when Eli was going to say, according to your desire, what did the Bible recall that Anna went to meet Eli?
I was crying, oh man of God, I have suffered in my husband's house.
Did the Bible record that? But all of us women, we will go and meet the man of God. Then we will cry. Some people will even say, I don't know what. And then the man will tell you that it is by me sleeping with you that the problem will go. You wanted him to sleep with you. You wanted him to sleep with you. It's not because he said so. You wanted it. Oh, we are so lazy Christians. Dish it out for me. Take away my problem. Do it for me. Do it for me. I don't want to bear it. I don't want to think about it. I don't want to know how. Just help me. Help me. Help me. Let it go. Who is fooling who? It's those men of God that I pity. You know, men are, I mean, they women, we are like that. And then when they see you crying, they pet you, they are soft at heart, they'll pull you, this woman's burden. Some people, some women, there is no time, they cannot call a man of God. There is no time, they can't call him. In the middle of the night, in the day, in the night, and be crying, and be crying, and be crying for him. Why don't you cry to Jesus? He's truly the one that can take away your problem. He's a servant. He's there on an assignment. He cannot take away your problem. He himself has his own problems. So don't stop blaming the man of God. He's not the one that slept with you. You slept with him. You destroyed the anointing in his life. You did it. It's not him that did it to you. You did it. You did it. All right? And then when it comes to the money, issue of money in the Bible says, as you have purposed in your heart, give. Isn't it? As you have purposed in your heart, then you give. Nobody forces you. You give to the work of the Lord. You know, I believe that this scheme is just a scheme of Satan to destroy the church. It's a scheme of darkness to pull down the church of the living God. It's the scheme from the pit of hell to destroy the works of the Lord. That's it. So many people have so many stories about church. And then they use that as a yardstick whether or not to go to church. Or probably to return back to the beggarly powers. Or to say they are not going to church and they live as they please. You will bear the consequences of your action. You will bear it. It will not be an excuse for you. Not here on earth, not even in heaven. That actions that you are taking, those things that you are doing, those excuses that you are giving, that you went to church and this won't happen, that won't happen, it will not justify you. It will not justify you. Not in any way. I know people that don't go to church now, all they do is call prophet and prophetess on the phone and, you know, pray for me. And those ones will say, send 100 and something thousand. Send so money. I will use it to pray for you. And they send it. So don't deceive yourself. We're all just, you know, finding excuses to do as we please. We are all finding excuses to do as we please. How long have you been born again? Did you just become born again today? And then the pastor seduced you and took advantage of you? How long have you been in the church? How long have you been born again? How long have you had a Bible? There was a time I prayed for 2 hours in a day and the Lord said, I'm lazy. How long do you pray? How long? Tell me. How long do you pray? How long? You don't read your Bible. You don't even go to church for Bible study. You only go to church when it's to make you feel good on a Sunday morning. Everybody's dressing up, so I show off my best dress on that day in the morning, on Sunday morning. Isn't it? We like to show off. We use that avenue to socialize. We see ourselves, hello, and we know how to speak the Bible languages. And then what the preaching does not go into your head is how this sister is walking, how the brother is talking, how this one packed abreast. That is all that we have come to check in the church. And then when problem comes, you don't know what to do. Then you now say, Bible, pastor, pray for me. Just lay hands on me and let my problem go. You are just going in the circle. You are just going round and round in the circle. Christianity is not about that. When you say you are a Christian, you have been born again 100 years ago. You were born in church, named in church, dedicated in church. Your father and mother, they are pastors. And then you say one pastor took advantage of you. That one took advantage of you. You are not deceiving anybody. You are deceiving yourself. You are just being used by darkness. And you allow yourself to be used by them. Okay, and devil can use anybody. If he desire to sieve Peter, he can desire you also. All you need to do is to pray. Stand in the place of prayer. When I was young, when I was still a child, my father always told me that when you go to church, pick the word of God. What have you gone to learn there? Have you benefited there? And then you pick that and you go. Because even the pastor is still working out his own salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. Every day the Lord corrects the pastor himself. So don't see pastor as God himself. And say it is whatever pastor do that I do. If pastor says I should sleep with you, then it is right. Don't you know? Are you telling me that you don't know? Or you don't know pastor's wife? You just slept with her husband and you are being best friend with the pastor's wife. You call her mommy. You call her auntie. You be a friend. You go to their house. Yet you are sleeping with her husband by the side. And yet it is the pastor that is wrong. It's not you. It is the pastor. Isn't it? Isn't it? I'm talking about true pastors now. I'm not even talking yet about the two other categories of pastors. I'm talking about true pastors. When a true soldier, when a true general of the Lord is pulled down by you, then you should weep. Then the church should gather up and pray for the man so that he can be restored from where he's fallen. Not that you should now, that is not enough. You now take it in your mouth again. You broadcast it. You tell everyone. You pull him until he's flat on the floor. He has fallen. It's not enough for you. You want to pull him down and put your leg on his head. That's what you want to do. That's exactly what you want to do. You see, let me tell you one thing. The rod of the anointed of the Lord is not in any man's hand. The Bible says, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. David was chased unto death by Saul for how long? But he didn't touch him because he understood what it means to touch the anointed of the Lord. If the man has truly been called by the Lord and you have helped to pull him down, and you are also helping, whether you know about it or you didn't know about it. You heard them talking about it and you quickly put your mouth. What you do not understand, what you do not know, you do not understand. You help to pull down dignitaries. The rod of the Lord will touch you. When the rod of the Lord touches you, when Satan afflicts you, you can run to the Lord. When witchcraft afflicts you, you can run to the Lord. When man afflicts you, you can run to the Lord. When God is the one that is set against you, who are you going to run to? Who are you going to run to? What you do not understand, run away from it. What you do not understand, say, I don't know. It is well. What I do not know, I do not put my mouth in it. What I do not know, and then a lot of people hear one side story and judge. You hear one-sided story and you conclude. It is only a fool that does that. You have only heard one-sided story. I've been in the position of a pastor for a while. If you hear one side of the story, you will feel like killing the other part. But you hear the other part first before you make your judgment. Then you will know who is truly telling the truth and who is lying. A lot of people out there, you hear one-sided story And then you conclude, you judge, you make your, you pass your judgment. You are just foolish. That's the display of your foolishness. It's the display of your foolishness because you are just only being manipulated to take one side. You are supposed to be fair. Listen to both sides and say, okay, well, this is what I think. After listening to both sides, not after listening to one side. People now come to church. You pull down the church of the living God. You pull down the man, a true man of God. Even, you see, let me tell you, even if the man has really done the wrong thing, okay, and you help to pull him down, the rod of the Lord is upon you. You know, every day, I say it, every day, people, you are praying every curse upon my life, an inherited curse, generational curse. You break down one, you pick another one. By doing that, you think that the rod of the correction of the man of the Lord is in your hands, is not in your hands. Let the Lord correct him. Even when the Lord corrects him, you will also stand in the gap for him and pray for his soul and pray and ask God for mercy over his life. All right? So, but if you go to churches, you find yourself in a wrong church. Why wouldn't you find yourself in a wrong church in the first place? Because you're a lazy Christian. Because you are so lazy, you cannot pray. You cannot read the word of God. You have the Holy Spirit. You do not commune with him. You don't know you have the Holy Spirit. You are looking for Jesus everywhere. You go from church to church. They are doing miracle there. You are there. They are doing miracle here. They are there. They are doing one program there. They are there. What are you looking for? Tell me. Jesus is here. You are carrying him up and down. You have Jesus already. But you are looking for him everywhere. When I was born again, the old-fashioned born again, we were not taught to move from church. We didn't even have it on our head. But these days, everybody is looking for power. And it's not power or miracle that you're looking for, but magic. And God did not perform magic. He works miracles. Our God do not perform magic. He works miracles. So where you are looking for magic, you found nonsense. Where you are looking for power, you have found what is not. You have found the devil. You have found the devil. Where there is power, there is display of power, but the presence of the Lord is not there. It is the devil that is working all those miracles for you. And everybody is looking for that. You are all looking for power, looking for it. When power is within you, the Bible says, as many as received the Holy Ghost have received power. You have received power. Power for what? Power to cast out devils. Powers to raise the dead, to heal the sick, to unstop the deaf here, to work miracles. Where is power coming from? From the gift of the Holy Spirit. I taught us 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. There is 3, 9 power gifts. Power gift of faith, power gift of healing, power gift of working of miracle. It is of the Holy Spirit. And you have the Holy Spirit. Where are you looking for again? Where are you going to? They are doing this program here. Ahead of this program there. They are there going up and down. Some people call it prostitution, church prostitution, whatever name it is given. It is wrong. It is completely wrong to be looking for the Lord and going under every anointing, every evil doctrine, whatever. You know, you don't know that whoever you submit yourself to matters. But some people don't submit themselves to one. They are all scattered everywhere. You listen to this person this Sunday. You listen to another person this Sunday. You listen to that person this Sunday. No wonder your life is going to no direction. It's us everywhere. There is no focus. There is no where you are going to. There is no where the Lord is leading you to. And he's leading you by just one man of God. Not by several men of God. You are so confused. You don't know what you are doing. Yet you say you are a Christian. What kind of Christianity is that? And you say, if I ask you now, you say you are born again since 1900. You were born and bred in church. You went to Anglican, you went to this, you have gone through all the churches that there are. There is no man of God that has not laid hand on you, and the problem is still there. You have given so many prophets and prophetess and priests money, yet the problem is still there. Yet you have not woken up from that spiritual slumber. You are still sleeping. You are still sleeping. It is sad. It is sad. And then the enemy has given everybody a job now, giving you a job to be pulling down the church and pulling down the man of God. If it's a true man of God, and if it's the church of the living God, and you set yourself as a gate of hell to pull it down, you are warring against Jesus. And when Jesus becomes your enemy, you know you are dead. You know you are a dead meat. You see, a lot of us, we are looking for what is not. We are looking, we are searching. I don't understand. The way through any problem, the way out of a problem is through it. Sometimes it's through it. Why? Because the Lord wants to bring out some virtues in you, but you refuse that correction. You refuse the word of the Lord. You don't want it. Just take away my problem. Yes, I want to continue to live my life the way I want to live it, but I want blessing. You can't have blessing. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. You are a product of all your choices and your decisions that you have made. And if wherever you find yourself is bad, is negative, you don't want to be there, change your decisions. Change. Start making the right choices. Change your ways. See, go back to where you are falling. What am I doing wrong? What am I supposed to do wrong? A lot of us, you are just going round and round and round in the same circle. In the same circle. In the same circle. Nothing has become better. Nothing has changed. You cannot vouch that you're a better Christian. You cannot vouch that you are anything. You cannot say that this is where the Lord is taking you to. Yet you have the Holy Spirit. You have the word of the Lord. You have everything you need in life. You have the word of the Lord. You have the Holy Spirit. You have everything. All you need is guidance. All you need is guidance. My sisters, my brothers out there, stop pulling down a true man of God. If he's a true man of God, if it is a church of the living God, don't be a part of those that are pulling it down. Talk them down, you know, pull them down, go out there and seduce them. No. And you say you're a Christian and I'm seeking the Lord. I want the Lord to give me this breakthrough. No wonder the Lord is quiet. No wonder the Lord is not answering. No wonder the Lord is just watching, because he says if he's to talk. If he's to do as you are even asking, you will be the first person to be pulled down. Let's be careful what we say there. As per those that are, as per the man of God, that is a true man of God that has fallen from grace, go back into your closet. Go back and sought the face of the Lord. Go back and ask the Lord for his mercy, for his grace. Tell the Lord to forgive you. Tell the Lord to have mercy upon you. Tell the Lord that, Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done. Yes, because your anointing was in your spam, my brothers. My pastors that are out there, the anointing, the grace of the Lord, all that the Lord wants you to be, he deposited it in that spam. And it should be dispatched on your matrimonial bed. If it is done outside, then it is gone to the enemy. These days, you see a lot of pastors do miracles. Where do you think they got the powers from? They got it, a serpent helped them to get it from a true man of God. And they transfer it to them, the virtues. They transfer it onto the fake ones. Because it's true, it's still the power of God. But you see the power of God, there is no presence of the Lord. There is no righteousness. There is no holiness. And the man of God can sleep with anybody and still come to the altar to perform miracle. The man of God can beat his wife and still come to the altar to preach. And the Holy Ghost will move. Everybody will be falling down. Once he raises his hand, like, everybody will fall down. You know? And then you lay hands. You don't have to lay hands. You only lay hands onto the sick, that they may recover. And it is not the pastors that are supposed to lay hands. Any brethren can lay hands if you have the Holy Spirit. In your prayer meeting, in your prayer warrior meeting, your prayer band meeting, in your little meeting, house fellowship meetings, you can lay hands on the sick and the anointing of the Holy Ghost will be manifested. All right? So don't stop looking for what, you know, for what is not. In my language, they say, "Enitoba wa wakuwa aririkuri." A lot of us out there, you are all just looking for nonsense. And once you are looking for it, you will find that kind of thing. If you say you are looking for that, you will find it, because the enemy is out there. Satan is out there. He is out to, is set to destroy the church. He wants to pull down the church. He is looking for ways to pull down the church. He has tried a lot from outside. And what did he do? He has come into the church to plant his agent, to plant satanic seed, to go into the brethren against ourselves. These days we find ourselves fighting against ourselves. We pull down each other. We talk down this person. We call names of ministries to pull them down, you know, because of the mistake of one of a body. The Bible says it is by their what? You will know them. By their fruit, you will know them. A man that cannot hold his own home. A man that chased his wife out. A man that his wife left him, that is an adultery. A man that cannot order his own children right. A man that you cannot see the evidence of the anointing upon his life. Yet you say that's your pastor. You follow him home. You cook for him. Your pastor is this. Your pastor is that. You see, when you say, when you go after somebody and you say you want that thing, can you see any evidence of that thing in his life? You are asking for counseling from your pastor that he himself and his wife are not together. Who is foolish? It's not the pastor that is foolish. It's you that is foolish. It's you that is foolish. It's not the pastor. It's not the pastor at all that is foolish. It is you that you have decided to be foolish, and you've gone, and he's taking advantage of your foolishness. Okay? We need to be careful out there. We just need to be careful and stop being a lazy Christian. Take your Bible in your hands and read it as well. You've heard a message. YouTube, read it. Go back to the references that were given in the message. Research it and say, God, what are you saying here? Talk to me. This message is large. Which one is mine in this message? Learn from it. But no, we don't do that. We are so lazy Christians. We don't pray. We don't spend any time praying. We don't seek the face of the Lord for anything. Then when problems come, pastor perform magic. Just take, pray and let the anointing flow. And a lot of people know how to put you on the spot. They say, as you were praying, and this one was moving. Pastor, pray. The pastor, just pray now. And then the man too will be wondering, what am I going to do now? Okay, let me do some, you know, he will also do some performance for you so that you keep following him. We are the one that make them like that. You made them like that. You turn them into God. You turn them into something else, and they want to flow. They too, they are flowing with you. They are flowing with you. That's what they are doing. So please, my brothers, my sisters out there that are crying that pastors did this for you, and a lot of members also do a lot of things for pastors, but pastors don't complain. Pastors don't complain. Pastors don't complain about you. Who do they complain to? But you, before you see any little thing with pastor, there is no repentance. There's no place of forgiveness for pastor. Because pastor is God, and once he has missed the mark, then he must be killed. How do you kill him? With your tongue. You must pull him down. You must kill him. You must finish him. You will destroy his ministry. That is your aim. Destroy him. You come against him. You've come against the Rock of Ages. You come against a true man of God. You have come against the Rock of Ages. And the Rock of Ages, when it comes against you, it will grind you into powder. It will grind you into powder. All right? So be careful out there. If he's a true man of God, he's truly anointed by God, and he has offended you, take it to the Lord. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Say, Lord, this is what this man done, this is what he's done, this, that, and move away from there. And move away. Move away from there. The Bible says, flee from all appearance of evil. Rather than him making you to sin because it's of his own weaknesses, then run away. Run away. Take your bags and flee. But rather, no, you decide, you put it, you, and it's not all churches that do that. It's not everybody that do that. I've met people that understand what I'm teaching you now. And when they don't understand it, they just say, well, I don't understand. And, you know, they leave it there. They understand the anointing. They know how the anointing works. And they know that the rod of the correction of their pastor or a true man of God is not in their hands. But a lot of people are just illiterate, Bible illiterate, spiritual illiterate. that are breaking one course and go entering into another course. You break one course, you enter into another course out of your ignorance. You need to be careful. You need to be careful. And wherever you are falling from, go back to the altar. Go back to the altar. Go back to the Lord. He's a gracious and a merciful God. Yes, Jesus said, I've not come to condemn you. I've come that you may come back to repentance. That is why I'm here today. You see, that's why I'm here. That's why I'm doing this broadcast. And as for those that are not called by God, but they have the charisma, they have talent, they're natural leaders, and they know how to cajole people and encourage and talk big. And they are now, when there is no evidence of the anointing, they now go and meet some demonic pastors. They join a cult. They are the one that use charm because they want the display of the anointing, because they were not called by the Lord in the first place. They were not called by the Lord in the first place. So be careful. If it is those people you are talking about, they weren't called in the first place. And it is your fault that you followed them. It is your own fault that you followed them. Why didn't you pray? Why didn't the Holy Spirit tell you that, don't go in there, my daughter. Don't go in there, my son. That is not the place I want you to be. Or let the Lord open your eyes and see beyond the visible. Let the Lord open your eyes and see beyond the visible. But because we are all lazy Christians, do it for me. Do it for me. Do it for me. Lay hands on me. You are walking with your eyes wide shut. Okay? Walking with your eyes wide shut. You are walking with our eyes wide shut. And an anointing that you do not respect cannot be a blessing to you. I've said it before and I'm saying it again. An anointing you do not respect can never be a blessing to you. And maybe peradventure the pastors you are talking about is the third category. Those ones, they are set for destruction. There is no redemption for them. You just need to be careful. And it is where you are looking for power, where you are looking for magic, where you are looking for, you know, fast that you fall into their hands. Because the Bible has already said it, that by their fruit you will know them. A man that has no Genesis, no time he was born again, you don't know where he is coming from, he just emerged from nowhere, and then he's declaring the power of God, he's showing you miracles, some miracles, signs and wonders, and you are all following him. Every wind of doctrine you follow, you blow, you know, you blow on every direction. And you say you are a Christian, you are born again years ago, you know. And you have just moved. None of the words of Jesus, none of the words of the Bible is leading you, is directing you. And a lot of people there, they come to church, but they still go and meet priests, satanic priests. They still go and meet prophetess that are using the spirit of divination. The prophets and prophets using the spirit of divination. Some of them are using spirit of witchcraft to divine for you, to foretell, fortune telling. That's all we are all looking for. We like fortune telling. Tell me what is in my future. Tell me what is in the plan for my husband. What? Tell me what is in plan for my children. Tell me what is happening. Hey, I'm doing this. Tell me. You have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can reveal all that to you. You don't need a prophet or prophetess again. All they are there for now for you is to confirm what the Holy Spirit is already telling you. Is they are not to divine for you. Yeah, just divining for you by darkness. And they can tell you, of course, they can tell you some few things. And it's not everything from the spiritual that is from God. You need to know that. It's not everything that is from spiritual that is from God. So, and the enemy does not know the end right from the beginning. He likes to camouflage himself as if he's God, but he's not God. And our God is awesome. Our God can turn things around. Our God is the God of impossibility. He is the God that knows the end right from the beginning. He is the only one that can do what you cannot imagine, what no man can even imagine. And he's the only one that has a way where no man has a way, where there is no way again. The Lord has a million ways, yet we do not seek him. We seek after those beggarly powers, those powers that are muted. We go after demons. We go after them and we call them. They call, of course, will they tell themselves? They'll tell you that they are demon. The Bible says Satan is a liar and a father of it. So he's going to tell you he's Jesus. He's going to camouflage himself as a minister of light. That's all he's doing. But you cannot see it because you do not know the original from the fake. You cannot differentiate it. And it is as a result of your laziness. And the truth is, when they are doing Bible study in the church, for you to be there, that's when you are busy. You cannot go. It's Bible study today. No, they are not performing miracle today. But that is the one that is going to deliver you. That is the one that is going to save your soul. But that is the very one that you have decided to ignore. That's the very one you've decided to ignore. And then the more you go round and round, you find yourself just going round in circle. You find yourself going round in circle. So please, let's stop, you know, talking down pastors. If it is a true man of God and has been brought down, let's pray for him. He's a general of the Most High, and that has been pulled down. He has been caught by the enemy. And what we need to do is for him is to rise again, to pray for him, stand in the gap, not to help, also to destroy him, to pull him down, to destroy the little one that is has left. Then we help again, we join hands. The enemy use our tongue to pull him down the more. You need to be careful. You need to be careful. And even you yourself, if you know you've fallen from any height, go back to the Lord. Let's go back to the Lord and pray. And stop talking about pastors. You talk about pastors, you have your own as well. Every one of us, we have our own weaknesses. We have everything. We have one thing or the other that the Lord is still dealing with. Everybody has it. There is no one that do not have it. There is no one that do not have it. You all have it. And don't forget that pastor is a man. Flesh and blood just like you. He's married, has children. He has dreams, and he has problems as well. He has his own challenges as well that he's seeking the face of the Lord for. And he's just a man that has more responsibility than you. He has more a burden that's been put upon him by God. A grace put upon him. Go out and do this for me. Go out and do that for me. That's who he is. He's not God. Don't see him as God. Sometimes when he's preaching, part of what he's preaching is to himself as well. The Lord is also talking to him as well. Even most of the time, when the Lord gives me a message, he first of all corrects me. He starts with me. The message is for me first before he sends me out to people and say, go and tell my children. They are there. They are there out there that needs this message. So don't see him as God. Now see him as God and you say, oh, he did this, he did that. How many times have you as members of the church, have you done one thing or the other? So many people confess, oh, they slept with this, they slept with that, this one happened, that one happened. What did the pastor do? What did the pastor do? Didn't he pray for you? Didn't he ask you to repent? Didn't he tell you that was wrong? Then why do you now have to kill the pastor? You kill him once he's fallen. He's a soldier that is falling, then you put your leg on his neck as well. That's what we all do. That's what we all do when you do that against pastor. Say, the pastor, he did this, he did that. It's not him that slept with you. You seduced him. You are the one that seduced him. You are the one that seduced the pastor. Bear that in mind. You seduced him. He's a man of God. You knew he's married, isn't it? Before you slept with him, you even know his wife. You play with his wife. You joke with his wife. You are his wife's friend. Yet, he's the pastor that slept with you. You seduced the pastor until he cracked and eventually gave in and slept with you. Because the following day, after he slept with you, you still went back to him. You still went back to him. You didn't repent from it. You didn't say it was wrong. You still went back and you did it again and again and again and again. So it's not the pastor that slept with you. You slept with him. You wanted to sleep with him. You have always wanted to sleep with him. So stop blaming the pastor. Stop, you know, putting all the blame on the pastor. I'm not saying that the pastor is justified to have done that. But don't put all the blames on pastor. All the blames is not on pastor alone. It's not on him alone. You have some blame as well. Take it and rise from wherever you are falling from. Take it as the message of the Lord to you all today. Take it wherever you know you have fallen from. Rise from it. Go back into your closet and talk to the Lord. I thank you. God bless you. I hope that you have a good Saturday. But I believe it's a food for thought for all of us. All right, it's a food for thought for all of us. And those of us that are, I wanted to talk about tithe. A lot of people say they are Christians I go to this church, but I pay my tithe here because I don't want them to eat my money. It's still part of the ignorance, I'm saying. Wherever you fellowship, whichever assembly that you go to, and they are praying and watching for your soul, that's where you pay your tithe and you give your offering to. But apart from that, we have ways that we give love offering and seed offering. I'm a part of many ministries. I bear into the mission, into the vision, and to the mission of the ministry. So I give. I see the good work they do. I give into it. I give into the into a man of God's life, even to those that are ministering to me, those that are feeding me with the word of the Lord, those that are watching for my soul. I don't want them to do their work with pressure. I don't like them to do their work under some kind of anger or anything. I know a lot of people. Let me tell you one thing. This is my own personal testimony. I know a lot of people that I stand in the gap before the Lord to stand and pray for them. And I hear all the nasty things they say about me behind. Somebody that I'm standing in the gap for to pray for. And I hear that, oh, he said this, he said that. I believe he's the Holy Spirit that wants me to hear all those things. Because it's not, I didn't go out seeking to find what, who said this, what said that. But I'm standing in the gap, praying, traveling in prayer for you, that this thing in your life must happen. That one in your life must happen. And I hear that you say, no, how do you think I'm going to feel? Next time, do you think I'm going to have that kind of strength to go all the way and pray through for you? That's what we do. An anointing you do not respect and honor can never be a blessing to you. It's not a curse. I'm not cursing you. I'm just telling you the truth. These days, Christianity is being destroyed. And it is not us. It is originated from the pit of hell. But the bad thing about it is that Satan brought it inside the church. I said, let's walk it from among them. I cannot destroy. I've tried to destroy them from north, from south, from east, from west. They are defending. Let's come in among them. And then once it crept into the church, you can see that he's able to, is walking. You need to stop it. You need to stop being a gate of hell. Jesus said, I will build my church and he will build it. His words are laws. They are decrees. They cannot be reversed. Said he will build his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. No matter where the gate of hell is coming from, whether it is from within or it is from outside, the gate of hell will not prevail against the church of the living God. He will build it. He will build it. So don't set yourself as a gate of hell. And don't use all these excuses as a yardstick for you not to fellowship. Not to seek the faith. When you go to church, don't gossip. When you go to church, if you need counseling, do it where other people are. Do it. Don't wait for counseling when everybody has gone. Only you and pastor is the one remaining in the church. Then that's when your own counseling can start. Eh? Why can't you do your counseling when others are there? Why can't you do your counseling now in an environment where there can be weaknesses? No, they don't have to listen to what you're telling your pastor, but there is a conducive environment. Not an environment that is conducive for sexual perversion. That is when you want to talk to pastor. Nobody else is in church. It's just you and pastor. And that's the only time you want to do counseling. That's the only time you want to do counseling. Who is seducing? It's you that seduced the pastor. It's not the pastor that seduced you. It's you. Yeah, there are pastors out there. I've told you before. If he's a true man of God, you seduced him. But if it is not a true man of God, then it's your fault that you fall into his hands. It's your fault that you fall into his hands. Because why? The Lord has said it by their fruit, you will know them. You can tell. If you know, if you are in the spirit, if you are born again, you have the Holy Spirit, you are reading the word of God, you are praying. If you get to a man of God and is not a man of God, the Lord will reveal it to you before you subject yourself. And I don't know where it says in the Bible that is until the man sleeps with you that your problems will disappear. I've never read that before in the Bible. I don't know where it says in the Bible that until I anoint your vagina, I anoint your breast, anoint you on all your private part, then your problems will disappear. I don't know where that is in the Bible. Have you seen that before? I don't know. I don't know where it says in the Bible that until the man of God bath. Have you heard it? Read it anywhere where Elijah bad for a woman, then she had the fruit of the womb, or Elisha bad for a woman and she got healed, or the dead rise, or it was Jesus, or Paul, or Peter, or John, any one of the apostles. Did you read it anywhere there? If not, because the evil powers of your father's house, those idols, those ways that we are so used to going to Abalist, those Abalist consultation that we are so used to, that you must do one thing, you must have your bath with one special sponge, then that's when the problem will go. You have been having your bath with those sponges till date. The problem is still there, yet your eyes is not opened. Your eyes is not opened. I don't know why we are quick to blame. Blame. It's not anybody's fault. It's your fault. It is your fault. So accept your fault. You know, rise from wherever you are falling. That's the good thing about the Lord. Rise. You can rise from wherever you are falling. If you are falling, you have now realized your mistake, then pick up yourself from there. Pick up yourself. Pick up yourself. Ask the Lord for mercy. Ask the Lord for forgiveness. He will wash you, cleanse you, and purify you. And then from there, you can start afresh with the Lord. Start reading the Bible. Read the word of the Lord. Listen to Bible messages. Listen to Bible. I've told us before to read the Bible. Read the account of Moses. How did the Lord walk with Moses? How did the Lord walk with Gideon? How did the Lord walk with Joshua? How did the Lord take the children of Israel? How, what did it take from Israel into Egypt? How long did it take? How many of them entered? What happened on the way? What destroyed some people? What didn't destroy them? Esther, who is Esther? How did Esther? Those are the ways to read the Bible. Read the characters in the Bible. Learn about them. Nehemiah. Who was Nehemiah? Who was Jonah? What makes him a prophet? How did he walk with the Lord? What about Jonah? That is the way. Then when it comes to the New Testament, read about all the accounts of Jesus. All the message that Jesus was teaching us. Read about it. What did he say about the Holy Spirit? What did he say about how we live our life? What did he say about repentance? Then go back now. Go to all the epistles that the apostles wrote to us. What is he correcting us over? What did he correct the Galatians, the Colossians, the Thessalonians? How did he correct them? What were they doing in those churches? What was the correction that the Lord was giving through the epistles that he wrote to them? That's the way to read the Bible. That's the way to read it. And there are so many literatures out there. So many on different subjects. Faith, giving, Holy Spirit, righteous living. There's so many literatures out there. But we will not avail ourselves of any of those literatures. We will not read. We will not pray. We can't read the Bible. We can't read the Bible. We can't read any literature that anyone has written. We can't pray. But we are quick to blame the pastor. We are quick to blame the pastor. It's pastor that did this for me. Pastor did that for me. In the church, you gossip. When we call Bible study, you won't come. But when it's prayer, you come because you are so lazy, you can't pray on your own. It's only when they are praying in church that you pray. You need to learn and develop the act of prayer. Lord, help us in Jesus' name. I don't know if there's anyone out there that has never given his life to God. Or you've given your life to Christ and you've fallen from a point. I pray for you. I ask that the Lord will have mercy upon you. Confess to the Lord whatever it is the sin is. You don't need to go and confess to a man or to a woman or to anybody. Just say it. The Holy Spirit, this is what I've done. This is what I did. 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 And I'm so sorry for it. I repent from it today. I will never go back to it. Holy Spirit, I invite you into my life. Come and help me to live this holy and a righteous, a Christian life. Help me day by day. And from today, go to a Bible-based church. I didn't say a miracle-working church. I said a Bible-based church. That's what we need. It is in the Bible, in the Word of God, that there is miracle. All right? I didn't say go to any church that they're advertising on TV where there is miracle 24/7. No, that's not what I've asked you to do. Go to a Bible-believing church. And when they are searching the scriptures, be there. Ask questions, you know, if you need to ask the questions, and pray. And the Lord will lead you into glory. He will lead you to victory. He will lead you to overcome. In the mighty name of Jesus, He will lead you. God bless you. And I heard that there is a message coming up about demonic pastors. This broadcast If you still want to listen to it, it will be on our YouTube TV channel. It's called Prayer House TV. You can listen to it again. It's just the message, the burden that the Lord put it in my heart to tell you. And I just, that's why I gave you the message today. I pray that you have a good Saturday. Very soon, I will give you more message. God bless you. Thank you.